So anyway, what a blessing that we're all going to have tonight of just this. And I want to show you a few of the things that she has. She has 12 of these boxes, and their subject, I'm checking here what the subject is, and the original documents here, and she has 12 of these. And this is how they came in these boxes.
That was the best of the boxes.
This is the best of the box.
A lot of them were just ratty old.
Yeah, just
boxes hard. From the this supermarket that has were kicked in.
Clicks and everything. That's great. That's what she started with.
Ruth, how did you get that?
You didn't get what?
How did you get them? What do you ask?
Oh, these?
How did you get them?
How did I get them?
Yeah.
Yes, I got them from
Jeff.
Laura.
No,
Jeff.
Jeff.
Alman.
Alman. Jeff Alman was living in Isabel's house. Mm-hmm. Had been married to Medora. So he's still there. And what's that big box of papers you have back there?
Well, that's actually the family papers that they haven't given us.
Oh, the family papers that they haven't given us. But Jeff brought Jeff Rawls for he might as well be here as just sitting over there. So besides what's there, she'll tell you how you can take care of your own papers and how you can file them. And this is even an index of what you have here. So you can see all you have to do is just sit down with a pencil and paper. Just do that. Catherine works at the where?
Barry University.
Barry University. Oh. And she drives early in the morning, if you can make it. That's at the end of the Dade County up there. And so she gets up early and drives up there and gets home when she can. So it's going to be fun. We're going to. I borrowed these from the city of Homestead that doesn't lend things out. But they did this time because. With the Main Street and I, we were going to share an outfit together, but they're so slow about doing it that although her year starts in October, with the process that they have of elimination of everybody that applies for these grants, they haven't awarded them yet, and it'll be about another month. So I said, that's why I need it, because it's the city's fault that she doesn't have the money so that we can vote for it. So anyhow, now we have this on loan, and we have Catherine here to help us. And then afterwards, if you have any questions, and she'll be happy to answer them. I'm thinking of other things I want to tell you, but I'll think of those later. And thank you so much for coming.
Well, Ruth has already told you I've got like 13 boxes of this, and that's sort of how I got involved in this whole project with the museum. I worked with a graduate student, Meg Feelings, and Meg did the initial work on here to try to organize some of the things, and then I've tried to finish it up. This is just the first 20 pages for the first, I think, three boxes. So it's pretty detailed, and hopefully someday we'll even get it online. But what we initially found, if you're an archivist and somebody gives you boxes of clippings, you kind of look at them and say, no thank you. But we looked at this and said, these are a real mess. As I said, this has been all insect eaten. They've eaten off all the paper on part of the box, and this was the best box. I couldn't keep most of the boxes. Some of them were old supermarket boxes with the tops cut off and the files in all horrible shape with insects and road droppings and dead roaches and silverfish. And so all of that, you know, had to go out. We had to rebox everything. We had to clean everything as we went. And I don't know whether you have seen a lot of materials, but if you have really acidic paper, you'll find out that your files will turn brown. So this is sort of an example of what happens with some of these. You can really destroy your files. And this is eating into this paper, but it's also from the original paper. And the worst offender, of course, are the clippings, which is why most archivists don't want these files. If you take clippings, usually you photocopy them and throw these away because they're so dangerous to your collection. Some people, if it's very important, will spray them with a deacidifier. But actually, we didn't do that because people are kind of coming to the conclusion that this takes so much work that it's not really worthwhile to do it. Some of these clippings have been around for, in the case of some of these, they're over 100 years old, some of them. They're still there. They're acidic, they're brittle, but they're functional. Another thing that people often do is put things in magnetic scrapbooks. And this, again, is the worst thing, especially if you put newspaper clippings in, it sort of bonds to the material. And a lot of times you'll put things in here, it'll bond to the material. And as an old professor of mine used to say, they stew in their own juices if you do that. So that's the problem with that. And then people oftentimes put things in little old glassine envelopes. And those two have done their damage over the years because they're not archivally sound. So our first task was, you know, let's clean up the collection. Let's try to get all the droppings out and the papers clean. And we had various ways of doing that. And then we put them in archivally sound folders and archivally sound boxes. And surprisingly, we used to say that if you keep materials, they should be at 70 degrees plus or minus 5 degrees and 50% humidity if they're papers plus or minus 5%. Now they're saying, well, that's not as important as it used to be. And if things are in good boxes like this, it'll take really a long time before the humidity will actually damage things. So, you know, it's a good thing to know that when you have things in proper enclosures, they'll last longer. So anyway, that's sort of the story behind all this. And now I want to tell you a little bit about Mrs. Crone.
Catherine wasn't here.
No. Isabel Crone was born Isabel Greenwood Burns in Milford, Connecticut on August 27, 1884. Her father, Robert Burns, bought an orange grove at Cape Canaveral and moved the family there about 1890 or 1892. I haven't found a solid date for that. She attended primitive grammar school on Merritt Island. And then, unfortunately, her father died while she was still very young. The U.S. Census for 1900 lists her mother as Mary Burns, a widow aged 48, and they say she's a farmer, and she owned a house and a farm. So apparently she inherited her husband's property and she continued working. And I can tell you it was mostly orange groves that they had. the census shows that she had a brother who was 17, who was a farm laborer, and I would guess maybe he took over when his father died, he took over a lot of the hard labor. Isabel is listed as being age 15 and at school, and her little sister is age 8 at school. And then there's another gentleman who was listed as being from Scotland, and he is age 70 and a boarder. And I suppose a lot of you know that back early in the 1900s, it was very fairly common for people to take in boarders. It helped with the expenses. And so particularly widows would have people living with them who would help pay the expenses. So I talked to Maxie Simmons before she died, and Meg Feely, who also was working on this, we talked to her, and she said that Isabel had said that her mother was a great reader and spent a lot of her time reading. It's hard to imagine when you have a grove and children running around that you have time to read, but apparently she did, perhaps to the neglect of the children, I don't know. And Isabel, Maxie said, was a great reader and read all the time, but not foolishness. She read serious stuff. She wasn't reading the romance novels and that sort of thing. She also said that Isabel had said that her mother wasn't very happy when they moved down to Florida, that she had a lot of friends and I believe family up in the Connecticut, New York area, and she was really upset to be moved away from them. And she also said that Isabel talked a lot about how she cared for her sister, how they used to go for walks on the beach and all the, you know, tried to entertain her. But Isabel also worked in the orange grove. So from the time she was young, she had a lot of experience with horticulture and farming. I mean, this was basically in her blood. As she got older, she attended high school in Titusville, and then she went on to business college in Macon, Georgia. But she returned after one semester. I've heard two fairly different reasons why that is. One said that she was needed at home because of the farm and to help care for her sibling. But also, shortly after, they moved to Miami. So it may be that they were anticipating the move. And so she was about 17 at the time. She apparently graduated early from high school. And they were contemplating this move to Miami. But if we look at the census from 1910, there's still a Burns family in Canaveral. And her brother, Robert Burns, is married and has two children. And then we look in 1930, and he has four children. Her brother actually died up there in 1957. So that part of the family stayed there. In the meantime, the 19th census shows the Burns family in Miami. So her mother, Mary Burns, is 48. She's 26. Her sister, Edith, is now 18. And there's an Anna Peck, age 29, listed with the family. But it doesn't really say if she's a boarder, but my guess is she might be a boarder. And if maybe some of you know if she's a distant relative or something, but I couldn't find any connection with her. So once Edith is, down in Miami. She's got a little bit of education from the technical college, and she becomes a bookkeeper at Fort Dallas Bank. The bank failed in 1907, so she was out of a job, and she then went to work for the U.S. government land office, and that's where homesteaders registered their claims. And we've pointed out this as some of the early claims. Now, the first inkling that she's met her future husband, William J. Crone, comes from Jean Taylor in her book on the villages of South Dade. And she says in 1904, Isabel went boating with Ernest Cotton, who was an engineer who worked with Crone on the Florida East Coast Railway. So they went to the dock, and on the way to the dock, they met William Crone. Ernest and William then started talking shop like guys do, and Isabel was just standing there waiting, and they were ignoring her. And I don't know whether this is what sort of turned her a little bit, but she said she liked Ernest, but didn't think he was very serious about her, probably because of this encounter. So nothing really comes of that, though they remain friends. She remains friends with Ernest Cotton. Another early friendship was Mary Drake, whose husband was Gaston Drake, owner of the Drake Lumber Company in Princeton. In 1908, he asked her to come and notarize papers at his lumber company. And so the two of them took the train down to Princeton. Afterwards, he asked the station agent to take her in a hand car to Homestead, where she planned to spend the weekend with Lily Lawrence Beau. And I guess, as most of you know, that's Avocado Drive, and they're neighbors. So I believe this connects with the next statement. Some of it comes a little bit from Maxie Simmons, and I think it's the same tale, that she walked by Crone's place, and he's working in the garden, and they had this long conversation, and there was some interest there. And Maxie said after that she started to visit Homestead quite often. So I think she realized that she was interested in this man. Maxie called her one of the most worthwhile people in the region. She really had the most respect for her intellect and her abilities. And they oftentimes, she said, you know, they would go off in a boat, and they'd go off into the Everglades, and they'd look for native plants. And Isabel Crone was also a great sheller, and there's some things in her papers about how she went shelling. And I know she kept up a correspondence with a gentleman who was supposedly a big researcher of shells, or a big collector of shells. And so they had a lot to talk about. November 1910, they get married. And soon after, every 2 years, they have children. So they had Mary and William and Bob and Jack. And they apparently lived in various places on Avocado Drive for various reasons, and some of them were very short periods of time, including the log cabin of Cotton, who she first dated. But Crone, of course, is an engineer. He was the chief engineer for the railway, and his office was in Marathon. His true interest was his groves, but he couldn't be there a lot of the time because he was working. So undoubtedly, she was very instrumental in running the groves, even with the children, because he had to be gone so much of the time. He even briefly quit the railway. There's a story about Joseph Meredith asking him, you know, you just can't do both things. You know, what do you want to do? Do you want to own a grove or do you want to work for the railroad? And he said, I'm really interested in working in my groves. And he said, then do it. And so that's when he quit the railway. But he really wasn't gone terribly long because Meredith wasn't well. Apparently he had diabetes and his health was really deteriorating. And people, you know, it got to be very noticeable. And so Flagler said, you know, I need to give Meredith a holiday. He needs to get away and rest. He's not resting, he's just working all the time. And so you have to come back and help him out. So he agreed to go back temporarily, but he was only there a few weeks and Meredith died. So that's how he became chief engineer on the railway. And he stayed there working part-time until he died in 1929. Isabel also did other things. I mean, it's remarkable how many things she was involved in. During the First World War, she worked on behalf of the Red Cross to raise funds for the European refugees. And during the Second World War, she was a local volunteer in the Army Air Force Wing Aircraft Warning Service. And I don't know the year, maybe somebody can help me out. She co-founded the John Elliott Blood Bank in Homestead. So I don't know when that started. But as I said, Crome dies in 1929. So here she is with her four children and all these droves, and it's the Depression, you know, 1929, the Great Depression. Even so, she was able to start her children off in college. And her son, William Crome, William H. Crome, became a well-respected horticulturalist. He went to college here in Florida, and he was eventually named to the Agriculture Hall of Fame. Another son became an engineer. He went to Princeton and got a degree. Jack was even employed by the railway. So he, you know, still somewhat of father's influence. The Cromes were a remarkable family. They still are. They're still doing research. They've been cited in numerous papers for their work in horticulture. They were known to introduce germplasma of many species and make selections of superior types. They were always trying to get the best plant that they could, and that was very important to them. They developed improved cultivars, notably the first Guatemalan West Indian hybrid avocados. And these became worldwide famous. I mean, this was a really big deal from, I don't know, I'm not an agriculturalist, but from people that I've spoken to, this was a really important step forward. They experimented with preparation of limestone soils, because that was a real problem. A lot of the breeds that they were bringing in, the varieties they were bringing in, wouldn't grow in the soils here. And a lot of people were planting things and they would die. So they did a lot of experimentation with the soil and how to plant things and make sure they survive. And also grafting and various things to ensure survival. They investigated fertilizer requirements, irrigation, and cold protection. And they were supporters of quality standards of tropical fruits, because a lot of the fruits were shipped out of the state, and they wouldn't be good because people wouldn't pick them at the right time. So they wanted to develop standards so that Florida fruit would really be outstanding. They also were not only doing scientific research, they were encouraging scientists, they were using, having scientists use their property and their groves for research. So it's not surprising that in 1929, Crome was ill, and most people knew that he was ill. And I think maybe he was anticipating that he wasn't going to live that much longer. So he and his wife and Charles Schaff donated 40 acres of land to establish the Subtropical Experiment Station, now the Tropical Research and Education Station. It's grown from 40 acres to 160 acres. Schaff was a president of the Missouri-Kansas and Topeka Railway, and he was actually a partner in their business, the Coral Reef Nursery. They also, Crome was a big member and supporter of the Florida State Horticultural Society. And in 1932, several years after his death, on the encouragement and I think the push of Isabel Crome, they established the Crome Memorial Institute. And they even have a fund, and they support research. They have scientific papers and do a lot of things within the Florida State Horticultural Society. So Isabel Crome was actually recognized by scientists as one of the most knowledgeable individuals in the identification and classification of mango varieties. That got to be her sort of main focus with a lot of the scientists. And she was instrumental in helping to create this mango, Florida Mango Forum. The first one was held in 1939. And it was instigated by the Florida Home Demonstration Program in Broward County and held at Fort Lauderdale. Dr. Wolf, the horticulturalist at the Agricultural Station, was asked to be their first speaker, and he insisted that Isabel Crome accompany him so that she could help identify the variety, the various varieties, and generally back him up, because he saw her as having at least as much knowledge as he had himself. So the second forum didn't take place. I think there were some problems with crop yields during the next few years. But in 1941, they had the second forum. And the man who succeeded Dr. Wolf, Mr. Lynch, then, was asked to speak at this one. And he was accompanied by various other people. And at the second one, there were 200 attendees. So then there was a third one, and a lot of the same people. Oh, I neglected to say that William H. Crome was the one who did the identification at the second. So I don't know if Isabel Crome was sick or busy doing other things, but she didn't go to that one. Her son did. The next forum, we have David Fairchild and a lot of other prominent speakers. And once again, Isabel Crome is inspecting and classifying the mango seedling exhibits.
Catherine, where were these held?
Different cities each time. They're all different cities. And I should have probably written down which ones were where. The fourth one happens, and again, a lot of prominent, well-known scientists. And this time you've got 500 people, and Isabel Crome is assisting Dr. Fairchild in answering questions. And the fifth one, they have attendance from 8 counties, and this one is held in Palm Beach, and she's again working with the exhibits. And the sixth one is actually held in Miami, and the newspaper says there are 1,000 participants. So it's just grown enormously. And she is in charge of classification with Lynch from the experiment station. And she's in charge of identifying the exhibits that are brought in. So she also published, which, you know, I didn't realize, she published in the Florida State Horticultural Society Quarterly and in the the Proceedings of the Florida Mango Forum. So her husband had previously published in the Florida State Horticultural Society of Florida a quarterly, because he was a member and a vice president before he died, so he was very prominent in that. But I think everyone acknowledged that she had an understanding of mangoes that was superior to most people in the state. They developed various mango varieties. There was an article published in 1954 in which the various varieties were examined, and the man tried to trace their origins and compare them. Of the 32 varieties that he was able to identify, 7 were developed by Lynch and Crome, and an 8th one was developed by Lynch, Crome, and Mustard. Only 3 of those were planted while William Crome was alive. So, you know, it seems obvious that Isabel Crome has certainly come into her own right as a horticulturalist. The sort of culmination of all of this was she was awarded the Thomas Barber Medal in 1948. It was the first time that Fairchild Tropical Garden made this award, and it was for distinguished service in the preservation of South Florida. And she was one of 7 recipients. And of course, she's in great company here. Charles Crandon, William Wybrin, Dr. and Mrs. Fairchild, and Colonel Montgomery. So that shows you how her peers regarded her. David Fairchild actually gave the presentation for her, and the citation acknowledges that she was the partner of her husband in the citrus campaign to eradicate the bacterial plant disease that threatened the citrus industry, and for his advisory work to eradicate the Mediterranean fruit fly. And that's the front and back of the medal. And he says, but she took a keener interest in the experiments made with tropical fruit, testing varieties of avocados and mangoes and many tangelos and citrus hybrids, which botanist Walter Tennyson Swingle made. Swingle was with the USDA in Washington, D.C., and there is some correspondence between them. The Grove was a horticultural field laboratory where were carried on studies of varieties, trials on fungicides and insecticide methods of packaging and storage and marketing of what were then strange new fruits to the northern market. And of course, you know, they're also opening new markets up in the northern part of the country. And you have refrigeration cars that can get fruits and vegetables places that wasn't possible, you know, earlier on. So you have some important things going on here, and they were participating in these things. It was long the dream of Mr. and Mrs. Crohn's to establish a tropical arboretum of their own where they could test out many of the tropical fruits that might grow in Florida. When this was not possible, they were among the first to donate their land to the state's subtropical experiment station in Homestead. The Crohn Memorial Institute of the Florida Horticultural Society recognizes the interest which the Crohn's took in the encouragement of plant industries. And they really were a very important family. Her advice and experience are a constant inspiration to those who start planting new fruits. And she did advise and help many individuals. Her critical ability and experience have been important factors in the organization of the Mango Forums of South Florida. Thomas Barber used to say, the medal is named after him, "David, let's go down to Homestead and see Mrs. Crohn." He felt the romance of the little brown house on Crohn Avenue. So, you know, it acknowledges the winner of the award and the award named after him. Mrs. Crohn is in the lower left corner here. And these are the recipients that year. This is when they received their medals. There are also additional contributions. The Mary Crohn Bird Refuge at Avocado and Crohn, land that was donated to the Audubon Society. And I have to ask, does anyone know, was that named after their daughter? Or was it named after Crohn's sister, William Crohn's sister? Because we have two Mary Crohn's. And I haven't been able to find information on
Bill, that. Bill Crohn's sister.
It was after his sister.
Yeah, I think so.
Because that's what I first thought, and then something else made me think, well, maybe I'm wrong about that. So it was named after his sister, okay. And there's a landmark court decision that I had not been aware of, and I don't know how many people are aware of. Isabel Crohn pursued insurance claims after a hurricane. And the insurance company at that time, the insurance company said, the only way that you can make a claim is if your trees are 100% destroyed. If there's a little life left in that tree, then we're not paying for it. And she said, that's not right, because these trees will never be the same. And we've suffered a great injury. And she took them to court over a period of several years, pursuing it. And it was finally decided in her favor, and it revolutionized the way insurance growers' claims are made. Yes?
Yeah. Catherine, your facts are accurate, but this was actually a tax court case. It's the IRS commission.
Oh, thank you. Right, yeah.
And it is fundamental. I don't do this form of law, but in tax claims for destruction of a grove, it's absolutely classic because they did side with Crohn, as your facts state. But it dealt with the deductibility of the casualty loss.
Yeah, sorry. No. Okay. Glad we have a lawyer in the house. Keep me honest. And there were also various other people who would seek out her expertise. And one that I picked out was Dent Smith, who was called the Pond Man. And he was a bond salesman and publisher up in the New York City, New Jersey area, who then moved to Daytona Beach and assembled over 2,000 ponds from around the world. And he then founded the International Pond Society. He just was enthralled by ponds. And he visited Miami on a number of occasions, and he wanted to meet with every single person that had a decent collection of palms. So he wanted to talk to all the collectors, see what worked, what didn't work, find out all he could, probably see if he could find some more things he could collect for his own collection. And he complained to Nixon Smiley, "I haven't met Mrs. Crom." And they said, "Well, but Mrs. Crom is, you know, she's tropical fruit person. She's not a palm person." And he said, "I don't care. I want to meet her anyway." And so they had brunch at the Smiley house. And apparently they were just talking and talking and talking for 3 hours and nonstop. And he was very interested in what she had to say about tropical fruit trees and about palms, because she had a great knowledge of native plants. And there's correspondence between Smith and Crom in the Smith papers at Fairchild Tropical Gardens. So they did keep up then some sort of relationship. As we talked about, Isabel Crom papers are mostly clippings and journal articles, and that's what we thought, and we said, okay, we'll work on them anyway. And then we discovered that so many of the things in there were also these wonderful original documents. So I don't know why everybody, the family included, labeled them as just her newspaper clippings. But they actually were extremely important, especially when you think about back then when we didn't have the internet, and it was very hard to get information. I mean, and she had friends and acquaintances in Europe, in Central America, and all over the country who would send her clippings about things that were of interest to her, primarily people that she was interested in and plants. And she, others relied on her information within the collections. They actually would come to her and say, you know, "Do you have information about this?" And oftentimes she would go to her collections and find them, and some of them were these newspaper clippings that she had collected. And Isabel also traveled in the 50s and 60s. She was in Central America and South America, and she went to Europe. And part of that was to talk or to learn more about plants. So, you know, she still was active. This is the way that the arrangement of the collection was. We tried to follow the way she had things organized. She had people and places, and then she had a set called Avocado Files, and those are pretty interesting. Then she had trees and plants, and then a sort of general file, and there would be files on agriculture or different Seminole Indians, shells, because she was very interested in shells. So various little topics are under there. There were a number of what archivists call ephemera, advertising flyers from various places, travel folders, and some of them are just wonderful. There's one from Key West that looks like it's a woodblock print, and it's just a spectacular little pamphlet that she collected from, you know, way back, I don't know, in the 30s maybe. So the first part of the original documents that were taken out because the clippings were so acidic and in such bad shape, and then the second group is the clippings themselves. But as I said, when we were looking through this, we found a number of original documents. And there was correspondence with what are big names in the plant world. And B.S. Nerode is a noted Indian horticulturist. And you know he's really extremely famous for his work. He did the first detailed study of avocado flowering behavior. So he actually studied and realized that male and female flowers came out at different times, and he did a lot of work, and he's well noted in the field. And then Swingel, I mentioned before, was with the USDA, and he did laboratory work in Florida, and there's correspondence with him. And then Wilson Hopenow is an agronomist who is also very, very well known. He worked with the USDA, was the first director of the Pan American Agricultural School in Honduras, and he worked for the United Fruit Company in Guatemala. He would come back to the States several times a year on business, and oftentimes he would come to Miami area. He would go visit the Crohn's and some of the other, you know, the Fairchilds and some of the other folks around. And he's well noted because he explored the flora of Central and South America. He tried to select plants and to send them back here to see how they would grow. So, you know, the important names that she corresponded with. She was also a great friend of Nixon Smiley, who, of course, was a Miami Herald newspaper reporter and local historian. An environmentalist, and he wrote the agriculture, the horticultural column in the Miami Herald, and became extremely knowledgeable, did a lot of plantings on his own property, and he became the acting director of Fairchild Tropical Garden, and was there for a number of years. It was more than just an acting director gig, I think, if you're there for 7 years. But he relied a lot on Mrs. Crone, and the History of Miami has the Smiley papers, and there are letters from Isabel Crone within his correspondence. She repeatedly supplied him with clippings about things. So she was acting as a source for some of his columns. And she would suggest things like, well, have you looked into this? You know, you really should research this some more. And here's an article about this, and you really need to do some more research. And she even says that she's looking in the attic for a clipping of her husband. You know, within his papers, he has this clipping that she was sending him. And he said that he wanted to tape record her, and this was sort of late in their lives, so I don't know, I've never heard of any recording. It would be nice if it would be out there, that would be great, but I don't know that he ever got around to it. So the avocado files, so-called, by Isabel Crone, have correspondence and tests. A lot of it was about the oil content of the avocados, because California passed an act that you could not import things below a certain percentage of oil. So they were doing a lot of research on this and trying to get the California laws overturned. Because actually they said the California avocados weren't as good as the Florida avocados, they were just being protectionist. And so it really had no meaning. But as you can tell, some of this was done before William Crone died. But there are also a number of tests that were done after he died that were obviously Isabel Crone's tests. And there are also order shipments, correspondence, costs and returns, the rows, sometimes they're little diagrams of what's planted where, seedlings, grass. And then after 1929, there's studies. So these are Isabel Crome's studies. Location, row, tree, kind, type, weight, fruit, season, tentative outline for studies of keeping qualities of avocados under different temperature conditions, because I think for shipping, they were trying to make sure they would arrive up north in the optimum condition. So that's it. If you have any questions, and if you have any ideas for me.
So what is the best way to keep newspaper clippings?
Newspaper?
Not at all.
Most people say it's better to photocopy them, you know, write down where they came from, the date, and all that information. But just photocopy them and toss them, because they're usually pretty acidic. And now we're so lucky, they've had the government has funded a newspaper project for the United States. And so many of the newspapers in all the various states have been filmed on microfilm, and now a lot of them have been done digitally. So you can actually find a lot of things online now, and hopefully that'll increase. The one thing that I found interesting in here, and I kept with the original documents, are the key veterans news. So right before the hurricane, there were, we have four issues of the veterans that were down working in 1935, before most of them. Yeah, before most of them were wiped out, and we have issues of that. And the only other copies I know of are in the Monroe County Library System. So, I mean, there are all these little gems within our collection.
So if you are archiving your family papers, is there like a set system, like for, you know, like that you should put things, you know, or can you do like, this is Crome's collection is, you know, personal correspondence, plant stuff, shell stuff, or is there a set, you know,
system? Archivists usually try to reproduce the system that the person was using. And with businesses, that's very important, because you can understand how the business was structured. I've gotten a huge garbage bag full of, hi, this is our family correspondence. We want to dump it. Well, then you have to decide, you know, how, what's in this bag.
Well, I was going to say, is it better to do things just in chronological order? Or
a lot of things are done either alphabetical or chronological. If, like that bag, there were five main correspondents, so you might want to put them under the five people that wrote them, and then chronologically. But it's how you use the papers that sort of determines what you do with them. And it's organized. If you're the owner of these papers, it's better to organize them the way it's most useful for you.
These papers here, were they indexed by her or by the archivist?
The main headings, the people, the Florida places, those were actually her headings on the boxes, because these are the things, and plants and trees. I don't know whether she didn't consider trees plants or what, but that's how she identified. There was a couple of boxes, and they were plants and trees. So we tried to keep it as much as we could to her organization, but she had apparently put some of them away and then started new boxes, so they were sort of the same headings. So we combined those with the original ones, or, you know, we just put them with a later date. But yeah, it's, and some of the things are really amusing, like, I'm trying to remember what the politics were. Her title on the politics is like politics and other waddle or something. And so it's really amusing the way
you have a sense of humor.
She had a wicked sense of humor apparently, and she didn't abide fools lightly. So you could be on the receiving end if you were acting foolish. She would cut you down in a very apparently precise and surgical way. But her friends loved her, whether she did that or not, because she was a very amusing, I think, woman, and very, very focused and interested. But she was also a hard-headed realist. And, Maxie made a remark that I don't know whether she wanted other people to hear, but that she thought, she didn't think that much of Marjorie Stoneman Douglas. I think she thought she was just so idealistic that, but she was practical, and really she had to be. I mean, a woman who's raising four children and running boroughs and doing all the other things, she probably had to be very, very focused, very regimented, and that's the way she approached things. Yeah.
One other observation. From your talk, she seemed to be more noted for her expertise in mango varieties, and yet her files don't have that as a separate file. She has the avocado file.
Well,
is there similar material?
The missing mango files.
Yeah, where's the mango file?
They're probably at Medora's house.
We don't have all the papers.
Yeah, well, this is...
We don't have all the boxes.
They probably weren't supposed to be in here. I'm sure the family would have kept them if they'd known they were in here, but they didn't, and they've given us permission.
They thought all we got were a bunch of clippings.
So, there were a lot of other things
so
in here.
So the secret mango files.
Yes. The secret mango files, yeah. Like
the family secret.
Did you live by herself for how many years, or did you give me the...
I think she lived by herself. That's my understanding. She drove a Rambler. Who was telling me the story of her mowing lawn and her when she was elderly? They went by and she was out there mowing the lawn.
Yeah.
She was like 90 or something. So
she had a white paper that I recall, and the sides of that car she had was high up, and I remember her driving by my house, and all I could see was the top of this white mat. And she was driving like that, very slowly, and I knew that in my bed, I just was crying.
My first job at Homestead was at the Homestead Grocery, and she was a customer there. She always had for a hat.
Yeah.
And she didn't spend much time except she just got her groceries and went. And tell me whose papers you work on when you work.
Oh,
at her job, her real job.
My paying gig.
Yeah, that's it.
I work on the Congressman William Wayne papers. And he's an amazing figure. I just have so much respect for him. You read the things that he did. He was head of the school board. We don't have those papers during desegregation. So, he suffered a lot from that, but he went on. They kept pushing him and saying, run for office, and he did. And he brought in well over $800 million to South Florida for the mass transit system. The People Mover, Tri-Rail, all of the mass transit, that started under him, because he was head of the subcommittee for the Transportation Appropriations Committee. So we have all the transportation, and then he was also on the Foreign Operations Committee. So he was all over the world visiting various leaders. I can't even begin to think of all the different people, but you know, we have pictures of him with the Pope and Lech Walesa and Castro and you name it. He did things like I guess you know he has the huge automobile dealerships in Miami, and his son now runs that. But he had the money to charter a jet and go down to Cuba and get three political prisoners out of jail, talking to Castro, who'd been in prison for about 20 years. So he brought them back. And on his own money. Yeah. So, I mean, there are all kinds of little gems like that he was involved with. So that's what I do otherwise.